This video discusses the graph data structure, examples of what graphs can model, and some terminology. It's the first video on a playlist for basic graph algorithms, followed by a video on the most common ways to represent graphs. I promise you, if those are the only two videos you watch today, they'll be among the five best ones, or your money back. You want all the terms precisely defined? Get a freaking textbook. This talk will be boring enough with just some informal definitions. Graphs are one of the most important, versatile, and widely used data structures out there. Here, I'll mostly just talk about using graphs to model a few different domains. But let's start by defining the absolute basics. Graphs are a set of vertices or nodes and a set of edges between vertices. We usually draw edges as lines connecting vertices. Starting with a graph for Facebook, each vertex stands for a person and an edge between people means they're friends. Edges represent some relationship between the vertices they connect. In this case, Facebook friends. For graphs, we say those vertices are adjacent and say that the edge is incident on its vertices. Just for scale, Facebook's a pretty big graph with over a billion vertices and hundreds of billions of edges. So what does it mean if you have your privacy settings set so that only your friends can see your posts? Those are your vertex neighbors in the graph. For me, that's just my dog and my cat. But I changed my settings so that friends of friends can see my posts. That adds all vertices on a path of length 2 away from me, which is much better because my dog has 1,200 friends. His vertex has degree 1,200. My vertex has degree 2. Want to link out further? How many people will you reach if you allow 3 or 4 edges? How about if I just allow anybody with any path for me? That would be all vertices reachable for me in the graph. Want a bigger graph? Think about the graph of web pages. Each web page is a vertex with an edge to another web page if it has a link to that page. Notice there's a fundamental difference between this graph and the one for Facebook. In Facebook, the friendship relation is symmetric. I'm friends with my dog if and only if my dog is friends with me. When all relations have to be symmetric in a graph, that's called an undirected graph. Web pages aren't like that. One web page can link to another without being linked back. That's called a directed graph or digraph. And to draw it, we usually stick an arrow on the edge to show direction. Of course, pages can link to each other, so you can have an edge in each direction between two vertices. That makes a cycle of length 2, a path that ends up where it started. For a cycle, it really doesn't matter which vertex you consider to be the starting vertex. If you go A to B to A or B to A to B, those are the same cycle. If a cycle contains no smaller cycles, it's called a simple cycle. And if a path has no repeated vertices, it's called a simple path. Directed graphs with no cycles at all are called directed acyclic graphs or DAGs. Cycles in undirected graphs are similar, but just to be clear, if you use an edge to get somewhere and then use that same edge to get back, that's not a cycle. It's just cheating. You can't just take a simple path, append it to its reverse, and call that a cycle. For web pages, it makes sense to think of the edges going from the page with the link to the linked page. What do links tell you about a page? What does it mean if a page has a high in degree? Well, that page is probably an authoritative or expert page on something. If you have 1,000 different web pages out there all talking about butterflies, and they all have a link to one page, that page probably has something to do with butterflies, even if it doesn't have the word butterfly anywhere on it. That's one of the ways that Google can figure out what pages highly rank for search terms, even if the term doesn't show up on the page. On the other hand, think about pages with a high out degree. Like Yahoo, assuming that's still around. The number of edges out indicates it's probably a directory or a collection of some sort. Depending on what you're modeling, sometimes edge direction won't be so obvious. In Twitter, you might want to think about who you follow and model an account with the edges to those the account follows. Or maybe instead, you want to think about the flow of information from the Twit to all of their followers. When you model that graph, you need to decide what edge direction you want to use. Either way is fine, but be consistent. These examples so far seem a bit similar, but we can use graphs to model more physical, real-world things too. Of course, the underlying physical communication channels of the internet itself can be modeled by a graph. In that case, you might want to model some extra information with each edge, like the capacity for that edge, how much data it can carry, right? An optical wire carries more than copper, right? We store that data with the edge and call it a weighted graph. Want to figure out where to lay your next cable for more robust connectivity or to maximize data flow between two locations? That's a connectivity or flow problem. In weighted graphs, what the weight means is completely dependent on what you're modeling. If you're modeling a flight, it might represent the cost of the flight or its duration. Want to minimize the cost or the duration or some combination of both to get somewhere? That's a path minimization problem. The edge weights can really stand for whatever thing you're trying to optimize. If it's a seating chart for your wedding, that weight might represent how much your Aunt Betty despises your best man, and you're trying to pick tables to minimize how unhappy your guests are. That's a clustering problem. Graphs are so versatile that it's hard to say what a typical graph problem looks like. They can be used to map shortest distances, find cheap flights, minimize wiring in a house, plan bus routes, optimize cable placement, choose Amazon warehouse locations, decrease gasoline usage by FedEx, schedule classes, recommend friends on Facebook, plan parties, solve Rubik's Cube, or figure out the 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon. You know, that kind of thing. Not surprisingly, depending on what you model, there'll be some differences in what you want to allow. Directed versus undirected, weighted or not, those are probably the biggest differences, but there can also be more minor questions like whether or not a vertex can have an edge to itself called a loop. For any particular problem you're modeling, loops may or may not make sense. On the other hand, graphs only allow one edge between two nodes, or one in each direction for directed graphs. Multigraphs can have parallel or multi-edges. Hypergraphs even allow for hyper edges, which connect an arbitrary number of vertices, but that's pretty much all I know about them, so that's kind of a short video. The next video on the playlist is on graph representation, but for now, I've got to go. My dog just posted a status update. Licking himself again. TMI. Show off.